When we are talking about COPD care and care of people with COPD, we need a patient as our partners. We need them and us to both know what their baseline is. What can they do? What kind of symptoms do we have? We need to identify goals. If we have goals, I think we're much more likely to get patients' buy-in if we work toward their personal goals. And then, of course, we have to provide them with action steps. You've got to tell them what to do if this happens or that's happening. We want to also prevent exacerbations. And one of the best ways to do that is earlier identification of the symptoms that are leading to the exacerbation and the increase in symptoms. And we also want to know when we can stabilize their symptom burden, what their symptom burden is from day to day, and when it's getting out of the comfort zone for all of us. This is the tool that I like to use. I think it has several parts, and you really want to make sure you understand all the different parts. Now, most people know about the green, yellow, and red days, but it's important to recognize these are a little different. There are specific questions for the patient to ask themselves about, is this a green day and my activity level is normal, or is it a yellow day and I'm more breathless than normal, or this is a red day that I have disorientation or confusion, a severe shortness of breath. Which one of these days is it? And then the other side is, what action will I take? In the green day, they're going to keep on with their usual activities. It just reinforces activities and medication. In the yellow day, it reminds them that they may need to limit their activity. They need to report they're having problems. And if they've given special medication to take, they need to take it. The red gives them permission, I think this is really important, to call 911 and start their special medications if they're so short of breath and having chest pain or coughing up blood. So I like this action plan that you can go over with the patient. Now, the part in blue I also like, because I think this gives you some idea of what your patients can and can't do, and it reminds them what they're having problems with. The backside of this action plan is really helpful for thinking about exacerbations. Why do we worry about exacerbations? Because they have a very negative impact on the patient's life. Quality of life, symptoms, cost, they increase mortality risk, they accelerate lung function decline. All of these things happen with exacerbations. So what can we do to help the patient become a partner in preventing this? These are the warning signs of exacerbations, and this is when you want your patient to notify you of the top ones, like the fever and the change in their mucus, or you want them to call 911 if they have blue lips or fingers and they're severely short of breath or have chest pain. But these are the things that I think, especially the top part, are important, that we could maybe recognize the exacerbation earlier. So where do I find the action plan? Well, the easiest place, I think, would be to go to the COPD Foundation Pocket Guide. So you can download this from the Apple app or the Google Play Store. It's free. And you can look for it under COPD Pocket Consultant Guide. When you do, these are the faith pages that you'll see. And there is now a version out that has a health professional section and a patient section on it. And you can see with that little toggle switch at the top, you can go either way you want. Let's toggle to the patient app so you can show you then how they go on to the flowchart, and the action plan will pop up and they can record daily how things are going with their COPD. This is important to have both you and them have access, and this is one way to do it. sometimes things don't go exactly the way we'd like them to go. Most of the management of COPD happens in primary care, and one of the reasons is that we do have a shortage of pulmonologists. But there are times that we really need to think about getting additional support and expertise for COPD management. And the COPD Foundation has developed a little algorithm. It's called Help Out, and I think it's very useful. So if the patient's been in the hospital, they probably should be seeing a pulmonologist. If they're having more than two exacerbations or even two or more exacerbations a year, and you're having trouble controlling them. If they have low lung function, what does that mean? Usually if their FEV1 is in the range of 30 to 40% of predicted, you probably like expertise. If the patient's having problems sleeping, is it their COPD or is something else going on? Certainly those that have oxygen needs, I find it very helpful to have the pulmonologist and their staff work through those. If the diagnosis is uncertain, or if there are therapy options that I'm just not comfortable with or not familiar with, perhaps the PDE4 inhibitors, or if we talk about patients with emphysema and we're talking lung volume reduction or valves, I'm going to want the expertise of a pulmonologist. So I use Help Out to guide when I ask for a pulmonology consultation.